Hello friends, welcome to the teleconference on milk processing. Today I am going to discuss the cleaning and sanitization of dairy equipment, which is a very important process in the dairy plant, because to supply the safe and clean milk which has got long shelf life and better quality, it is necessary that the dairy equipment in which the milk is processed should be clean and they should be free from microorganisms. Now, the cleaning is the process of removing any extraneous matter. It may be dirt, it may be dust, it may be the particles of the milk which is being processed from the surface of the equipment. With the help of water, it may be cold water, it may be hot water, and a suitable detergent. The sanitization, on the other hand, is the process of reducing the microorganisms to a level which is acceptable to the health authorities, public health authorities, and it in terms of detection and destruction of pathogens and minimizing the other microflora which is there on the surface of the equipments. It is very important that an appropriate type of detergent, first we will be discussing the detergents which are used for cleaning the equipment, and then we will be discussing the sanitizers. So first the selection of detergents. For a proper cleaning of the equipment, the detergent should be of appropriate type. It should not be irritating to the person who is cleaning the equipment. At the same time, it should not be corrosive to the surface of the equipment which is being cleaned. So for a better type or for an appropriate type of detergent, there are certain criteria which should be follows. These are the type of soil present on the surface of the equipment. Number two is the manner in which the soil is formed, whether it has been formed by processing the milk or whether the milk has been heated, and if heated at what temperature, what was the pH. So all these things will decide the manner in which the soil is formed. Then third criteria is the chemical composition of water supply. What type of water is there which is being used for the processing and for the cleaning of the equipment. Then fourth is the nature of the food being processed or food processing steps. Which type of steps you are following, whether you are processing the liquid milk, whether you are manufacturing the product. So all depends on the nature of processing steps. Then plant design, construction and material used for the same. If the tin material is there, different type of detergents will be required. If it is aluminium, then different type of detergents will be needed. Then the extent of cleanliness and sanitation which is required. Then the cleaning and sanitizing technique which are available in the plant. So these are some of the criteria. Then before discussing the detergents, it is important to know what is milk soil. Any equipment that store, carries, contain or contact milk will accumulate particles of milk on its surface. This is called the milk soil. The composition and concentration of cleaning compounds and the cleaning methods which are used depend on the type of soil on the surface of to be cleaned. Then the chemical composition of typical milk soil, just for example it is given, the constituent which are there, then the cold milk soil, what type of composition it has got, hot milk soil, whether it is scrap heat, surface heater or it is tubular heater, and then the milk stones. the composition, the in case of cold milk soil, the concentration of lactose is about 38% in the soil, fat is about 30%, protein about 26 or 27%, and the S content is about 5% or 5.3 exactly. Then in hot milk soil, the lactose is only in traces. On the other hand, more amount of fat, which is about 48 or 50%, and protein, which is about 40 or 41%, and the S content is also higher, about 12%. Then this is in scrap surface heater. If the milk is being heated by tubular heater, then in that case the lactose will be in traces, the fat will be about 22 to 23%, protein will be about 30%, but the major proportion will be of minerals, which is indicated by the S content, which is about 46 to 47%. Then in milkstone, if the soil is not removed immediately, it due to heating of the equipment surface, it is converted into milk stones, and the composition of milk stones is different than the milk soils. Lactose is not present or is present in traces. Then the fat concentration or content is about 3.6% to about 18%. The protein content is about 4 to 44 or 43 or 44%, but S content again is very high, which may range from 40 to 67 or 70%. Then these components, how easily or how difficult they can be removed from the surface of the equipment. Sugar, which is soluble in water, it is very easy to remove that. The change induced by heating and the soil surface, caramelization is there, more difficult to clean when it becomes caramelized. Then in case of fat, it is water insoluble but soluble in alkali, and it is difficult to remove. Due to heating, there is a polymerization, more difficult to clean this polymerized fat. Then protein, water insoluble, but they are soluble in alkali as well as in acid, very difficult to remove, and there is a denaturation in the heated milk, much more difficult to clean the heated soil. Then the minerals, monovalent minerals, they are water soluble, acid soluble, they are easy to remove, but the polyvalent like calcium, magnesium, etc., they form insoluble salt with phosphate, calcium phosphate or magnesium phosphate, and they are water insoluble but soluble in acid, they are difficult to remove, and their interaction with other constituent during heating, they get interact with other constituent like protein, and it becomes more difficult to remove these stones which have been formed by the interaction of minerals with protein. Then the second important thing, one is the type of soil, second is quality of water. It affects the cleaning. Means the water may be, two problems may be there. One is the suspended matter. Water may not be pure, it may contain suspended matter. These must be kept to a minimum to avoid deposits on clean equipment surface, because water, instead of cleaning the surface, will accumulate these impurities, suspended matter, on the surface of the equipment. So these things, suspended matter or particles, should be minimum or they should be absent in the water which is used for the cleaning. Second problem with water is its hardness. The salt of magnesium and calcium pose the major problem in the use of cleaners by reducing effectiveness and by forming surface deposits. Water hardness may be classified as the soft, moderately hard, hard, very hard, depending on the concentration of these minerals. The hardness, when the concentration of minerals is from 0 to 60 ppm, in the water, then it is considered as a soft water. When the concentration is between 60 to 120 ppm, the water is considered moderately hard. When the concentration is between 120 to 180 ppm, then water is considered as hard. And when it is above 80 ppm, then water is considered very hard. Then next thing comes steps involved in cleaning process. What are different steps? The steps are bringing the detergent solution into the close contact with the soil to be removed by means of good wetting and penetrating properties. Dissociating the soil, second step is dissociating the soil and liquid soils, the solid and liquid soils from the surface to be cleaned by saponifying the fat, peptizing the protein, means hydrolyzing the protein, and dissolving the minerals. Third step is scattering the soil in the solvent by dispersion, defloculation or emulsification. And the next step is preventing redeposition of the dispersed soil back onto the clean surface. These are the functions of the detergent. Then in addition to these things, the detergent, it should have other qualities in addition to the above mentioned functions. These qualities include, it should soften the water adequately so that the detergent remain effective. It must dissolve quickly and completely in water, be non-corrosive to the equipment which are being cleaned, be non-toxic to the person who are involved in cleaning. It should be economical, it should not be very costly, then remain stable upon storage for long period of time, be non-caking and non-dusting. Function of a detergent, the flocculation, it does the flocculation, means it breaks the soils which is adhering to the surface of the equipment, that is called defloculation. Then it must dissolve the soil after breaking it. Then it should emulsify the suspended fat and peptize or hydrolyze the protein. Then it should have rinsing power. Also it should saponify the fat into soaps so that it can be removed easily. Then it should have sequestering properties, means the minerals which are adhering, they should get removed. And then it should have wetting properties, it should wet the surface easily. Then classification of cleaning compounds and their major functions. The cleaning compound can be classified into several classes depending on which type of chemicals they are. These classes include the alkalis, and their function is soil displacement by emulsifying, saponifying and peptizing. Then polyphosphates are used. Their function is soil displacement by emulsifying and peptizing. Then soil dispersion in the water by softening the water and prevention of soil redisposition. Then there are surfactants which are used to remove the soil from the surface of the equipment by surface active properties, means it has got the surfactants, they have two type of groups, the hydrolyzing group and the hydrophobic group. The hydrophobic group will be attracted towards the fatty material and the hydrophilic group will be attracted towards water, and by doing so it will remove the soil from the surface. Then it should have chelating compounds. Chelating compounds will do water softening and they will control the mineral deposits on the surface of the equipment. then they will in the display, they will help in the displacement by peptizing the proteins and by prevention of redeposition of the removed soil. Then next class is acid cleaners. Their function is control the mineral deposits and softening the water. Then the relative efficiency of different classes of cleaning compounds. As far as alkalis are concerned, they have got all the properties, the dispersion, the dissolving property, emulsifying property, peptizing property, rinsing property, saponifying property, sequestering property, then suspending the soils, then wetting the surface, and they are at the same time corrosive. They cause the corrosive effect on the surface, whether they are mild or they are strong. Then polyphosphate, they are not corrosive, but they don't have saponifying properties. Other properties they have got. Then surfactant, they don't have peptizing properties, they don't have sequestering properties, and they are non-corrosive. As far as acids are concerned, they are not as effective as the alkali or the phosphate or surfactant because they are non-emulsifying, they are non-saponifying, they are non-sequestering, they do not suspend the soils. So in this respect, the alkalis or polyphosphates are better. We'll discuss them one by properties of these cleaners one by one. First, the alkaline detergents or cleaners. In this, caustic soda or NaOH is the main detergent. It is has got high germicidal action. It dissolves milk proteins, lacks defolliculating and emulsifying power. It is very corrosive and on hands as well as on metals. It irritates when it comes into the when the hands touch with the NaOH, then it is harmful to the hand and it is corrosive to the metals. Then second, alkali is the soda ash or sodium carbonate. It is very inexpensive, and it is very cheap. It has got good buffering capacity, but it has poor water softening capacity. It is a poor water softener. Only fair defolliculating power and emulsifying power it has got. Then trisodium phosphate. Trisodium phosphate, it has got high solubility, fair water softening capacity, relatively corrosive on tin, limited levels permitted. Because of the problem that in the wastewater, the level of phosphorus should not be very high, so the limited levels are permitted only as a detergent. Then, so the next category is sodium metasilicate. It is high active alkalinity it has got, excellent defolliculating and emulsifying properties, relatively non-corrosive despite strong alkalinity, protect metals from other corroding alkalis. It has got good suspending abilities, very effective in holding the soil in suspension during the washing operation so that complete cleaning is possible. Only a fair water softener it is. Fair water softening capacity because the calcium and magnesium silicate formed in hard water. When water is hard, the sodium silicate will interact with calcium and magnesium, and magnesium and calcium silicate will be formed, and because of that the softening of water will not be there. Then other category is modified sodas. These are mixture of soda ash, means the sodium bicarbonate and sodium carbonate and bicarbonate. They are useful for manual washing operations as they do not cause skin irritation. For hand washing of bottles, hand washing of can, etc., for that these modified sodas are suitable. Then next category is the acid cleaners. Acids are of two types, the inorganic acid and the organic acid. First, the inorganic acid. They are very corrosive, dangerous to metals, high concentration, dangerous to handle for the person who are cleaning. They are harmful, injurious to clothing, irritating to skin, low pH due to high degree of ionization. They are very strong. Under certain condition, some inorganic acid will precipitate the proteins. Then the organic acid like the lactic acid, tartaric acid, citric acid, acetic acid, etc. are also used, and these are better than the inorganic acid. Acid reaction tend to prevent and remove deposits of calcium and magnesium salt derived from either milk or water, can be combined with wetting agent, hence penetration will be better. Mild, stable, less corrosive, these are the properties. Safe, gentle and harmless to hands in use in dilute solutions. Then wetting agent, third category. Three type of wetting agents are there. Anionic, it includes sulfo soaps, sulfated alcohols, alkyl aryl sulfonates. Then second category is non-ionic. They are product of ethylene oxide and alkyl phenols. And third category is cationic. These are the category contain quaternary ammonia compounds. Now these wetting agents are very important because they help in wetting the surface of the equipment, and by wetting the surface the soils can be removed by the detergent very easily. Then next category is the sequestering agent. These are the chemicals which will interact with the calcium, magnesium, etc. And as a result of that, they act as a chelating agent. They will interact with calcium, magnesium, etc. and they will help in softening the water and also removing the soil from the surface of the equipment. They are EDTA. In this category, EDTA is there. First, it is heat stable, compatible with quaternary ammonia compound. It can be added to that. Then it has got bacteriostatic property. It prevent redeposition of the soils. Second category of the sequestering agent is sodium salt of gluconic and heptonic acid. They are stronger than EDTA in chelating calcium and magnesium. They require high concentration of NaOH for their effectiveness. Then third category is polyphosphate, sodium tripolyphosphate or and the sodium pyrophosphate. They are unstable to heat and limited levels is permitted, again because of the problem that in the wastewater their concentration should be kept minimum. For that only limited level is permitted. Then the fifth category, which are added to the detergent, the substance, it is the enzymes. Some proteolytic enzymes are mixed with alkali and surfactant, and they are used to remove the soil from equipment heavily soiled with proteins. Then the next category is chlorine. The advantage is that it increases the power of the alkaline components tremendously, the power to clean the equipment, and increase the peptizing efficiency. It also reduces the mineral deposits on the surface of the equipment. Then the last are the categories, the inhibitors and the anti-foaming agent. Sodium sulfite is used as an inhibitor for the thin surface, and the sodium silicate is used for the aluminium surface. Now As far as these detergents are concerned, no single detergent can fulfill all the functions. Hence, you have to use more than one, two, three substances. Only then you will get good cleaning efficiency from these detergents. The detergents, one can be used, then the chelating agent can be added, then the saponifying or the sequestering agent can be added, and some enzyme can be added to that. So three, four substances, when they are added together, then the formulation is more effective compared to any single detergents. Then second category comes the sanitizers. The sanitizers, they can be divided into three categories: the thermal sanitizers, which include steam and hot water. Generally, steam is not used because it is more expensive compared to hot water or even any other chemical or other sanitizers. So it is more costly. Then in addition to that, it is very difficult to control the temperature and contact time. Also, because of the condensation product, there is a problem of removing that product. So because of all these limitations, steam is generally not used as a sanitizer. Hot water is used as a sanitizer. And the advantages of using hot water are, it is easy to apply, it penetrates into cracks and surfaces, it is readily available, relatively inexpensive, relatively non-corrosive, and very effective over a broad range of microorganisms. Then limitations of the hot water are forms film or they contribute to their formation, thereby shortening the life of equipment or their parts. Then high energy cost is there, safety concern for employees because it is a very hot water, so it may cause problem for the employees who are involved in the clean sanitization. Then it is a slow process, because for coming up the temperature and cool down, it needs some time. So these are the limitations of hot water. Then second category is the radiation. By UV or cathode rays or by gamma rays, we can sanitize the equipment. Generally, it is not used for the equipment. It is used for some specific purpose. Say, for example, to sanitize the packaging material, the radiation is used. Then the third category of sanitizers, which are more common in use in the dairy plant, they are the chemical sanitizers. They are approved for food contact surfaces application. They are inexpensive compared to other sanitizers, low in toxicity and corrosiveness, readily solubilized, and possess some detergency also in addition to sanitization, stable under all type of conditions, tolerant of a broad range of environment conditions, destroy microorganisms rapidly, and have a wide range of scope of activity. In this first category is chlorine and its compound, acting on microbial membranes. How they kill the microorganisms? They kill the microorganisms by acting on microbial membranes, having a lethal effect on DNA of the microbes, inhibiting the cellular enzymes involved in glucose metabolism in the microorganisms, and oxidizing the cellular proteins of the microorganisms. Then second category, but in this type of chlorine type, it is very irritating, very corrosive to the equipment, but it has got some water softening capacity. Then second category is iodine and its derivatives like iodophore. They kill the microorganisms by cell wall damage, destruction of microbial enzyme activity, and direct halogenation of proteins of the microorganisms. The problem with the iodophore is again that it is harmful for the persons who use the or who are involved in the sanitization, but it has got better water softening capacity compared to the chlorine compounds. Then third category is quaternary ammonia compounds. third category of the sanitizers. Their advantages are that they are non-irritant, they are very effective antimicrobial agent, they also act as a surfactant, they remove the microorganisms by removing the soils from the surface. They are active and stable over a wide range of temperature, more active at alkaline pH compared to acidic or neutral pH. They leave a residual antimicrobial film on the surface of the equipment, which is good but sometimes is not desirable, say in the manufacturing, for the manufacturing of cultural product. If that film remains on the equipment, then it will have adverse effect on the production of these cultural product. These are non-toxic. Limitations are they form hard soil to remove, hard deposit, it is difficult to remove on rinsing glass, cause foaming problems, they are not effective in hard water. Then fourth category is acid anionic sanitizers. Their advantages is they are useful at low pH, have detergency property, good stability they have got, they have low odor potential, non-corrosive to the equipment, non-harmful to the employee who are involved. Then limitation, high cost. Then narrow pH range, 3 to 5 pH, they are effective only. Low activity on molds and yeast, excessive foaming in CIP, they are not suitable for in-place cleaning because of the excessive foaming. Then their uncompatibility with cationic surfactant and detergents. Then fatty acid sanitizers. These are formed by fatty acids and then some other acid like phosphoric acid is added to the fatty acid. So they are the mixture of fatty acids and the inorganic acids. Their advantage is that they are lower foaming potential they have got, so they can be used in CIP system. Broad range of activities there, so many microbes under against so many microbes they are effective. Highly stable in dilute solutions. Then limitations are non-effective above pH 3.4 to 5, non-effective against mold and yeast, unstable below 10 degree centigrade of temperature if they are stored. Then factor affecting the efficiency of a sanitizer. Physical factors, they can be divided them into three factors: the physical, the chemical, and the biological factors. Physical factors are surface characteristics, which is to be cleaned, what type of surface it is, then exposure time, how much exposure time is given, then temperature, what temperature you are using for the sanitization. Then concentration, how much concentration you are using, then type of soil, and the chemical factors are pH of the solution, type of water, whether it is hard water or soft water. Biological factors are microbial load and type of microbes. Then cleaning method, what methods are used for cleaning the equipment? These are either manual cleaning is there, which may be at low pressure with high volume of spray, which may be at high pressure with low volume of spray. It may be foam cleaning, it may be by washing machine, or it may be in-place cleaning or CIP cleaning. Then assessment of cleaning and sanitization efficiency. How you can assess the effectiveness of the detergent and sanitizers which you have used on the equipment. This you can do either by visual inspection. If you feel that surface is not clean, it will show the difference. If the equipment is very clean, then visually you can judge whether it is clean or not. Then touching the equipment, you can judge if there is some soil. By touching you can feel it. Then drop test. If you put some water on the surface of the equipment, the water will flow when the inclined surface is there or vertical surface is there, material will flow down and it will flow in straight line if the equipment is very clean. But if it is not clean, then the breaking in the line will be there. Then pH test you can do. If you have used detergent, their pH is more than 7. So if you just rinse the equipment and check the pH of the solution, if it is more than 7, then some detergent or sanitizer, they are remaining on the surface of the equipment, they have not been removed properly. Then indicator test, phenolphthalein you can use, because the detergent they have got more than 7 pH, so the phenolphthalein will give pink color. It will indicate if these detergents are adhering to the surface of the equipment. Then rinse method, you can rinse the surface with the help of water, and this water you can determine, in that water you can determine the bacterial count. If in 1 liter of that water which has been obtained by rinsing the equipment is up to 1000, then the cleaning is satisfactory. If it is more than 1000, means up to 5000, it is moderately satisfactory. If it is more than 5000 counts in a liter of water, then it is unsatisfactory. Then swab method, similarly you can swab the surface with the help of cotton and you can rinse the surface. This is known as swab and rinse method, and in this again the microbial count is determined. If it is up to 5000, it is satisfactory cleaning and the sanitization. If it is 5000 to 25000, then it is moderately satisfactory. If it is more than 25000, then it is not satisfactory. So by these methods you can judge the efficiency of the cleaning and sanitization. Then we have cans are used to take the milk from one place to another place. So generally can washers are used in dairy plant. So in short I will just discuss what type of can washers are there. We have can scrubber, can steaming block, rotary can washer and straight throw can washer. The diagrams are given. This is the diagram of can scrubber. It has got three brush, the A, B and C. Three brush are there. The A brush, on A brush the can in inverted position is capped. Now detergent solution is supplied with the help of electric motor. Now this with the help of electric motor, the brush A will rotate inside the inverted can, and the brush B and C, brush B again will rotate, but brush C brush is static. So these brush will clean the can from outside. So the with the help of these three brush and detergent solution and water, the brush the cans can be cleaned from inside as well as from outside. Then the steaming block is there. Here the can is inverted, and the with the help of spray nozzles the steam, the water and the detergents are supplied to the base of this steaming block and the cans are washed. Then it is a straight throw can washer in which the inverted cans are kept, and then the detergent solution, they are washed first with water, then detergent solution, then with hot water and with steam, etc. Then CIP system, in place cleaning. In this system the bigger equipment in the dairy plant, they are cleaned by this and sanitized by this process. You need not to dismantle the equipment. In place cleaning will be there, means with the help of pipes the water, hot water, the detergents, the steam, etc., can be circulated in the system and it will be cleaned and sanitized. Now, this type of CIP system, there are two types: the centralized CIP system, which will clean all the equipment, and the standalone type of CIP system, which is generally used for the pasteurizers, for the evaporator, etc. In that, there are tanks. In those tanks, the water, the detergent, sanitizer, etc., are stored, and the, with the help of pneumatic screws, pneumatic valve, they are supplied to these equipment. This is the diagram of the CIP system, and this is the diagram of the milk pasteurizer. So they can be cleaned by the CIP system or in place system. You need not to dismantle the pasteurizer or the other equipment, but through pipes they can be cleaned. So partner, this is, I conclude this, and if there is any doubt or any question, I will be happy to answer. Thank you. थैंक यू. हाँ, पता नहीं आए नहीं रहे क्या, कोई पूछता ही नहीं.